The Battle of Beecher Island, also known as the Battle of Arickaree Fork, was an armed conflict between elements of the United States Army and several of the Plains Native American tribes in September 1868. Beecher Island, on the Arickaree River, then known as part of the North Fork of the Republican River, near present-day Ray, Colorado, was named afterwards for Lieutenant Frederick H. Beecher, an Army officer killed during the battle. Background. In the summer and fall of 1868, continuing their annual seasonal raiding activities between the Arkansas and Platte Rivers in what was also the region of their best buffalo hunting, bands of Cheyenne and Arapaho Indians conducted raids against whites throughout the western Great Plains and Kansas. In addition, they found incentive in the warfare that had been waged specifically against their clans by the military in 1867, and by memories of such atrocities as the Sand Creek Massacre. Finally, the westward movement of the Transcontinental Railroad had stretched all the way across Kansas, bringing with it with many permanent white settlements. During the 1867-1868, the Cheyennes were in schism, with those advocating peace retreating south out of Kansas, and the younger, intractable warrior societies continuing to raid. The latter during the summer of 1867 had successfully avoided a large expedition commanded by Major General Winfield S. Hancock, and in the process had garnered sympathy from Americans in the East who supported peaceful negotiations after Hancock attempted to bully the Cheyennes to submit, and burned their abandoned villages when they did not. In August 1868, General Philip Sheridan, replaced Hancock in command of the Department of the Missouri, was asked by Acting Governor Frank Hall of Colorado for assistance after 79 settlers were killed in repeated attacks on farms, ranches, way stations, and travel routes. Sheridan's main effort was to be made south of the Arkansas, a winter campaign in the Indian Territory, but he remained active in Kansas during the warmer weather, patrolling the Arkansas with the 7th Cavalry, and the area between the Republican and Smoky Hill Rivers using the 10th Cavalry. Unit Formation. As the Indians fought dispersed battles composed of small bands of warriors all over the frontier, U.S. Army troops and units were at a premium. General Sheridan decided to try an unusual tactic. He ordered his aide, Major George Alexander Forsyth of the 9th Cavalry, a Civil War veteran, to raise a company of 51st Class Hardy Frontiersmen, to be used as scouts against the hostile Indians. They were to seek out and engage the marauders using their tactics, rather than those of the traditional army. Forsyth handpicked 48 men at Forts Harker and Hayes and armed them with Spencer repeating rifles. Forsyth's executive officer was Lieutenant Frederick H. Beecher of the 3rd Infantry, a decorated veteran of the Battle of Gettysburg. His company rode northwest nearly to Nebraska, then turned southwest and reached Fort Wallace the night of 5th of September without finding any trace of Indians. The engagement. During the morning of 10th of September, the troops at Fort Wallace received information that Indians had attacked a freighter's train 13 miles east of F.T. Wallace, near the railhead of the Kansas Pacific Railroad, which was the since-abandoned town of Sheridan in Logan County, Kansas. Brevet Colonel Forsyth and his group of scouts departed Fort Wallace with orders to counter the raid. Colonel Forsyth took his command to investigate. They learned that a force of about 25 Indians had taken part in the attack. They followed their trail into what is now Yuma County, Colorado. Indians spotted. The scouts trailed the Indian raiding party from Sheridan into Colorado. Signs indicated that the opposing force considerably outnumbered the scouts, but the unit nonetheless pressed on. Around dusk on the 16th, Forsyth and his men arrived in the vicinity of the Dry Fork of the Republican River and made camp on the south bank. They camped only 12 miles downstream from a large encampment of two Lakota villages, one of Cheyenne Dog soldiers and a few lodges of Arapaho. Indian surprise thwarted. At dawn on the 17th, Forsyth sensed trouble and spotted the silhouette of a feathered head against the skyline. He fired his weapon, instantly killing the Indian warrior. Simultaneously, other Indians, who, having moved nearer to where the scouts' horses were tied up, attempted to stampede them, but the scouts immediately responded to the sound of Forsyth's gunshot and only the pack mules were lost. Roman Nose, war leader of the Cheyenne, had planned a dawn raid to overrun the camp of 50 U.S. scouts, but the element of surprise was lost when a few eager warriors rushed the camp before the order to attack was given. Forsyth gave orders to saddle the horses. Seeing that no escape route was open, he directed his men to take cover on a sandbar in the middle of the Arickaree. The numbers of attacking Indians varies widely, with estimates including 200, 600 to 1,000. The initial assault by the Indians was cut down by the accurate, quick-firing Spencer rifles. The combined force of Oglala Sioux and Cheyenne Indians were surprised and changed their tactics. During the early morning of the first day of battle, small parties of Indians dashed up to the sandbar on horseback several times, but they did little damage to the scouts. The scouts killed their horses for breastworks and dug pits into the soft sand behind them. When the scouts opened fire, the Indians attacked the island on both sides. Later they crawled through the grass and shot through the grass. Several scouts who were killed or wounded were hit by the Indian snipers hidden in the grass. The Indians surrounded the island and repeatedly attacked the scouts. Three scouts hidden in hole on the riverbank shot several Indians from the shore. Roman Nose was shot on the riverbank at the west end of the sandbar. He jumped back into the grass where other warriors retrieved him. He died at 10 p.m. that night. Many other warriors fell, while four of the scouts including Beecher, Acting Surgeon J.H. Moores, George W. Culver, and William Wilson were killed. Another 15 scouts were wounded, including Colonel Forsyth. Forsyth received a mild head wound and his leg was fractured by a gunshot wound. Scouts sent for relief. Before dawn on the second day, Forsyth said, "Someone must go to Wallace for assistance." Sharp Grover, who was chief of scouts, said it is impossible to get out. Then Stillwell came forward and said, "Let me choose the man to go with me and I will go." Grover said, "Jack is too young and inexperienced, he can't get through." F.T. Wallace was about 70 miles to the southeast. But Forsyth tore off the fly leaf out of his daybook, wrote a note to Colonel Bankhead at F.T. Wallace, and gave it to Stillwell. Simpson Jack Stillwell chose Pierre Trudeau to come with him. They crawled for 3 miles the first day before they took cover in the daylight. They were forced to evade Indians for 4 days during their journey. 1370 They had only horse meat for food and when it spoiled they got sick. Trudeau was so weak he could only stand with assistance, but after resting and traveling for 4 days they reached Fort Wallace. 2 nights after Stillwell and Trudeau left, scouts John J. Donovan and Allison J. Pliley left the island to seek relief. It was unknown if scouts Stillwell and Trudeau had made it through the Indian lines. In the meantime, Forsyth and his men survived on muddy river water and rotting horse meat. Forsyth was wounded twice and others thought he would die of his wounds before they would be rescued, relieved. Three rescue parties departed following different routes due to the uncertainty of the scouts' location. The first was Lieutenant Colonel Louis H. Carpenter leading Troop H and I of the 10th Cavalry Regiment with Captain Baldwin. Major Brisbane in command of two troops of the 2nd Cavalry took another route. Captain Bankhead, went from Fort Wallace with about 100 men of the 5th Infantry, took a third route. About daybreak on 25th of September, Lieutenant Colonel Carpenter's troops H and I were intercepted on the plains by Scout John Donovan and four riders he had recruited after reaching Fort Wallace and starting back for the battlefield. They were the first to arrive and relieve Forsyth's unit. Carpenter later received the Medal of Honor for his relief of Forsyth's command and for his actions during the battle on Beaver Creek. Over 50 dead horses greeted them with their putrid smell. Forsyth's command had been out of rations and forced to survive on the decaying horse flesh. Forsyth's second-in-command, Lieutenant Frederick H. Beecher, had been killed during the battle. Forsyth had been shot in the thigh, fracturing his leg, and wounded in the forehead. He was not expected to survive another day. The air around him was completely filled with a great stench and was swarming with black flies feasting on the rotting defensive line of dead horses. The square sandy hole, where Forsyth was lying, was half encircled by dead mounts and would have become his grave if help had not arrived when it did. Other gun pits, interconnected, contained the living and the dead of his unit. Carpenter immediately secured the area and pitched a number of tents upwind nearby. The wounded men were carefully carried there for more healthy air and the dead men were buried to reduce the stench and possibility of disease. 26 hours later, Carpenter sent a detachment to look for Bankhead's unit. They found Stillwell and Trudeau several miles in advance of Bankhead. Captain Bankhead followed, bringing with him the two troops of the 2nd Cavalry. The following day, a fifth scout died of his wounds and was buried on the battlefield with the other four scouts. Walter Armstrong died in a hospital later. Beecher, Culver, Farley, Wilson and Dr. Mowers were buried on the island. 16 others were wounded. On 27th of September, the Forsyth scouts departed for Fort Wallace, escorted by the 10th Cavalry. Aftermath. The Forsyth scouts arrived back at Fort Wallace on 30th of September. General George Custer later proclaimed that the Arickaree fight was the greatest battle on the plains. To the Cheyenne, the engagement would be remembered as the fight when Roman Nose was killed. In actuality, the fight was a minor engagement of no lasting import whose greater significance, as a model for tactics and successfully combating the Indians, was largely ignored. The location of the battle was listed on the National Register of Historic Places in 1976. The next spring, Captain Brown returned to retrieve the bodies. He found Culver and Farley's remains, but Beecher, Wilson and Dr. Mower's graves were empty, apparently removed by Indians. Culver and Farley were reburied at F.T. Wallace.